I'm glad to be here tonight. I've been here already a few times in the past in Roslyn, but that's the first time I'm here in this beautiful place. And hopefully it's the beginning of a new start. Usually when the lectures go well, there's always another and another and another visit. Yeah, something is, if it's not going to continue like this, I'm going to have to talk without it. Without it, I prefer without it. But,
go fix it.
Go fix it. Okay, you know what? Until you fix it. Maybe you put it next to the electric or something like this.
Oh. 1, 2, 1, 2.
I wouldn't count on it so much. Hey, good evening again. This lecture tonight, it's called Life After Death or Life After Life. It's actually the same. And okay, enough. For those who knows me, you can come closer. Those in the back, there's plenty of room right here and rear. You can still come closer. For those who knows me, when I give lectures that involve with proofs, such as Torah and Science, some of the films that I made include this Life After Life presentation. I based it 100% on scientific proof, according to the medical world, according to the parapsychologist, according to the non-religious world. And then after I prove everything they said and everything they proved, then the goal is to show the audience that basically everything they found in the last 20, 30 years, when we're talking about life after death or reincarnations, hypnotizing people, all these things, that it's relatively very new in the scientific world. It's only not even 30 years old. This, all these discoveries that scientists found, I show that actually everything was in a Torah, in a Jewish Torah, thousands of years ago, before these scientists were born, before there were any medical world, you know. And basically, obviously, that brings some Jews to open up their eyes and realize that the Jewish Torah, it's a book that was given by the Creator of the world. So, okay, what's the point? That's where I'm heading to. Really, I'm not so interested to give interesting lectures. I know everybody likes to come and enjoy the lecture. The lectures are interesting as it is, because the topic is interesting. But that's not really my goal. What is my goal? And I don't want to hide it from you. I tell you up front. My goal is to make people recognize that our Torah, not most Jews don't know it. Our Torah, it's a divine book. Everything that is real, that is truth, our Torah already knew about it. Inside the Torah, in every chapter, every page, there is divine information that leaves no doubt that this is the Word of God. Why am I so anxious to prove that point? Because right next to it, it says that you have to observe the Sabbath and to put tefillin and to be generous and not to be angry and to be a great human being and to be a role model and to sanctify the name of God and to be modest if you're a woman and to be a great husband and a great wife and a grandparents and to raise your children in the right way. There's a list of requirements. When does a person is willing to change his lifestyle and follow the guideline of the Torah? Unfortunately, only in this generation, and I say unfortunately because in previous generation people didn't ask so many questions, they didn't need so many proofs, but today everybody needs proofs. When people are really finally agreeing to change their lifestyle and change their habits, only when they convinced 100% that this is not just another book. This is the book of my Creator. And that changed the entire game here. Because if it's just another book of recommendations that were made by the rabbis or by interesting people, who are they for me to listen to them?
We can't hear in the back.
That's fine. It's good, good for me. I need some exercise to work on my character once in a while. Not to get angry. Let's breathe. Very good. All right. I wish you would ask me. I'll tell you not to touch wireless. It's always been a problem. In all my seminars, 15 years, wireless never worked. And will never work. Here, trust me. Return it. You just open the bag. Return it. No problem. Those who don't hear me, I gave you the options. Come closer. The place is pretty big. Just come closer. There's many seats here.
There's so many here.
All right. In the front, there are seats available. All right. Let's move on. Shh. Now. For those who didn't know, 3,320 years, approximately 15 million Jews stood around Mount Sinai for the first and last time in history. The nation of Israel and no other nation but us heard the voice of God speaking to a human being. Moshe speaking and God answering him, and the entire nation of Israel are listening to the actual voice of God. Only once in the history it happened. How many words God said? The first two commandments. When he was about to start the third commandment, the Jews went out of their mind, they got panicked, and they couldn't handle the situation. The ground was shaking, as you can read the description of that event in Parashat Yitro in the Torah. The mountains was full of fire and fog, and the noise of the shofar was very, very loud in the background. The floor was shaking. God was speaking, Moshe was speaking, and that was the first time people actually heard the voice of the Creator of the world. It never happened before in a public event, and will never happen again. Once God agreed to come and give a group of people in this earth his actual book, the most famous book in history, the number one seller in all the generation by far. Almost every house in the world have this book. Even non-Jews have it in all kinds of languages. As the Torah was given to the Jews, right away was translated to 70 languages in that generation. All the other religions and cults based their religion of some of the things from the Torah, such as Christianity and Islam. That's not the topic tonight. I have a whole movie about it. As you can see, I show you a preview from that. That's a new film that we just made recently. If you're interested, you can see it. It's fantastic. It's mamash doing very well, Baruch Hashem. And it's growing by the minute. Hopefully we'll get to millions of people. We have a lot of Jews in the world that have no idea what they live for, unfortunately. They mamash live like another species nation. All they think is about money and good food and enjoy the materialistic world. They don't really understand that they have a soul and it's a divine soul. And they have a very important mission in life. They're just not aware of it. And they waste all their 70, 80 years that the Creator gave them. And every second of their life is a mistake. Very sad. That's really a Holocaust. Because just to die, righteous. The Nazi puts you inside the oven, he burns you into pieces. How long you suffer? 10 seconds. That's it. Death is only 10 seconds suffering, and it's over. The soul goes out of the body, as you're going to see soon. The person doesn't suffer anything anymore. What comes after? That's the question. That's the big question. Who are you? Depend who you are. That's what's going to come after. Some people are very happy to get rid of this world. Some people are begging to come back to get one more chance. I'm going to show you some of the interview that some of the people who died. But let's start. As you know, when we received this Torah, as I just told you, The Torah has 613 commandments. 10 were written separately on board of marble. But all the other ones are also an integral part of the Torah. There's really no difference. The 10 commandments are important. The rest of the Torah is important. It's the same divine book. 3 out of the 613 commandments are restriction from God to Jews, only to Jews, not to the other nations, not to communicate with the deceased people, not to bother them, not to ask them questions about the future, about the present, because it's disturbing the souls of the deceased people. So what are we understanding right away? Nobody wastes time giving a book to a group of people, asking them to follow the book, and write inside, do not talk to the dead bodies. Every fool knows you cannot talk to a dead person. Why would God waste 3 sentences in the Torah writing to us restriction with strict warning? Don't communicate with the dead people. Right away we understand that it's possible. The fact that we don't know how doesn't mean it's not possible. We just don't know how yet. We're soon going to know, 100%. Please. We're soon going to know how it's been done. But just that I don't know doesn't mean it's not possible. As we review the Torah right in the beginning of Sefer Bereshit, chapter 2, verse 7, the Torah described the creation of man. Vayitzer Hashem Elokim et Adam afar min ha'adama. Hashem created the body of the person, sand from the ground. Material, bunch of molecules, he puts it together, now you have a body. Vayipach be'apav nishmat chaim. Second step was to blow into his nostrils, like you put air inside the balloon. He took his nostrils and he blew, not air, don't get confused. A divine energy. You don't see it. You cannot see it. You cannot touch it. You cannot smell it. You cannot hear it. It's something divine. It lives for eternity. Cannot kill it. Cannot feel it. It's something that called neshama, soul. Everybody knows there's a soul. Even the goyim, soon you're going to see. Vayipach ba'apav nishmat chaim. A spark from the thing called God was put into the body of this Adam, this person. That means he became a combination of material and a divine soul, together, combined. V'ayi Adam le'nefesh chaya. What's the third step? And the person became alive. 3 steps. Body, from the ground. Blew a soul into his nostrils. He woke up. He started to talk, to hear, to walk around. He's alive. That's life. What's the opposite transaction? Death. How death is happening? A part of the Tanakh, in the book of Kohelet, chapter 12, verse 7, Vayashuv ha'afar el ha'aretz, and the sand will return to the ground as it was before. And the spirit will return to God because he is the one who gave it. Very simple. Exactly the opposite. The same way the energy entered the body, that soul entered the body, and the body became alive. Once that energy goes out of the body is nothing, like a rock. You cannot talk to it, you cannot move it, it doesn't have feelings, nothing whatsoever. No pulse, no breath, nothing. The energy will enter again into that body, that soul, again is alive. You take it out again, it's dead. Can play with that 100 times, in and out. It's in, you're alive. Take it out, nothing. No breath, no heartbeat, no brain waves, nothing. How do we call, scientifically, how does it call when a person died for a few minutes and came back to life? It's called clinical death. Or out-of-body experience. We will understand soon why. As we go into the Oral Torah, for those who didn't know, the Torah was given to the Jews as a combination of written and oral laws. The written laws are worthless without the oral laws that were given to Moses in Mount Sinai. You cannot practice one mitzvah in the Torah without the oral explanation how to do it. The reason why God separated from the written laws to the instructions, He gave the instruction verbally, and He did not write it in the same book, to hide it from all the Gentiles and all the nations that after they saw such an event in Mount Sinai, everyone was anxious to get a part of that book. Everyone wants to be close to the Creator of the world, who is Creator. Look at the going today. How many of them are willing to die by searching the truth? Kill themselves, explode themselves, sacrifice their life, give up all their money to charity. They all have good intention. Not all of them reach the right target, the right destination. But the idea behind it is that a person wants to be close to his Creator because he understands that's the great investment I will make in my lifetime. Who should I be friend with? With my professor from college? With my cousins? Very nice. They could be very nice people. There's not that much they can do for me. Being friend, being loved by my Creator, being close to Him, that's a very good advantage. We will see soon. So the oral laws were given separately. That even if the non-Jews, as they did, translated the Torah to their languages, they only understand it literally. But the truth is that literally it's really not what it means. For instance, I give you just one example. The Torah says you should have a sign on your hand and in between your eyes. And that's one of the three covenants that I'm making with you. That's tefillin. Nowhere in the Torah it says the word tefillin in the written Torah. Nowhere in the written Torah it says that it has to be black. Nowhere in the written Torah it says from what animal you make it, from what skin, how do you remove the hair, what you put inside, why inside the hand is one scroll and in the head is four separate ones. There's approximately 1,000 steps, approximately, more or less, between the time you slaughter the cow until you have a kosher pair of tefillin ready with all the instruction. If you messed up by one out of these 1,000, it's worthless. It's nothing. You put it, you bury it in the ground. It's like you didn't put tefillin all your life. Why? Something divine must be 100% correct. 99.9 is zero. It's like in computers. You did almost everything the same. One letter you miss, the computer doesn't understand. It gets stuck. Error, error, a million times, error. One dot. You only forgot one dot in a program. The computer doesn't work. That's how it works in Torah. You do it in the right way. You did it as God wished. You separate. You did it differently. You just didn't do it. And that's how it works throughout entire Torah, through Judaism. So we go now into the oral laws, and this is what the oral Torah had to tell us about the creation of mankind. Tanu Rabbanan, three partners in the creation of man: God, His father, and His mother. His father gave the whiteness of the body from this material that comes from the father. He have, his bones are created, the ligaments, the nails, the brain inside the head, the white inside the eyes, and the mother give the redness, which is the skin, the flesh, the hair, the pupils inside the eyes, comes from the mother. Comes God after the body form within 40 days. From the time that a husband and wife had relations, 40 days it takes to create the image. Male, female, it's 40 days. Then comes God and gives the spirit, the image of the face, the ability to see, the ability to hear, the ability to talk, to walk, wisdom, intelligence. Once the time arrives for a person to die, comes God and takes his share and leaves what his mother and father contributed, and the rest is obvious. The person cannot move, cannot hear, cannot see, nothing. This is The explanation of the creation of man. As I just told you a minute ago, the Torah says, you should not create any communication with the dead people. Lo imatze becha shoel ov, that's one way. Idoni, it's another way. Vedoresh el hametim. Do not ask the dead people questions. Right away, an intelligent human being understands, if God told me don't bother them, I understand two important things from that. One is that they remain alive without their physical body. They are somewhere. And second, I'm not allowed to call them. No long distance phone calls are allowed to the relatives that are already transferred to a different world. What are the reasons? It's irrelevant right now. Yes, you want to know, you come to yeshiva, I'll teach you why. But right now, that's not the point. The point is, we understand from one sentence in the Torah that all the dead people are alive somewhere. They really never finished, as we thought. And I'm not allowed to contact them. One other thing I know, that the goyim can contact them. They were not warned not to do it. Everything I'm going to show you in this lecture is based on researches of non-Jewish, non-Jews. They did the work. I take what they found and show you that the Torah basically say it way before these goyim were born. The Gemara in Masechet Nida, page 30, the Gemara says, what is a baby inside his mother womb? He is folded like a notebook. Then there's a spiritual light above him. And he is able to see the entire world. A spiritual vision, not a physical vision. And there's an angel who teaches him the entire Torah in those 9 months that he's inside. Once the time comes for him to come out to the world, the angel tap him on his lip and make him forget everything he learned, and he comes out to the world, and over here, 70, 80 years, he has to invest times and efforts and money to learn what he actually learned over there free of charge. He knew the entire Torah. The great student of the Ari HaKadosh 500 years ago, Rabbi Chaim Vital, those are the greatest Kabbalists ever been in history. And this is the way he explains it. The body of a person is not the real person. This is called the flesh of the human being. The flesh. The real person is the spiritual thing that enters that cover. That's called the soul. Whenever the Torah wants to refer to a person, to the body of the person, the Torah always say, Al Besar Adam, on the flesh of the person, the flesh of his body. The Torah didn't say Adam, referring to his body, never. When the Torah wants to speak about a body, the Torah makes sure to write the body of a person, the flesh, Al Besar Adam. But when the Torah wants to speak to the soul, the Torah say, Ah, Adam, the person. Because the person, this is only the cover. Nobody cares about the cover. It's what's inside. That's who you are. When you tell your wife, I love you, the body cannot love her. If you take the body, chop it to steaks, put it in a glad kosher place, wrapped, $9.99 a pound, nobody will tell the difference between the body of a Persian body, or Bukharian body, or Ashkenazi body, to the cow. It's all the same. Same molecules, same shape, everything the same. You put $9.99, people will buy the human body. Some of them will cook it. I don't know if anybody will eat it, but there's no difference. The body of a human being is less than a dollar. Water, iron, salt, you know, oxygen. What's inside the body? If you take the ingredients and buy it from the chemist, maybe with the inflation, used to be 97 cents, maybe $2 now. Like a slice of a pizza. When a person dies, nobody sues for $2, right? Just calling the lawyer costs you $1,000. What's the point of suing for $2? You know the joke with the lawyer. One guy called the lawyer and said, hey, I heard that you're charging $10,000 for one phone call. He say, Maybe. Maybe. He say, how come? He say, that's my right. What's your third question? I ask him for three questions, $10,000. First, I heard you charging $10,000. You already wrote in the bill. One question. How come? That's the second one. What is your third question? Anyway, we're going back. Once the soul separates from the body, if you didn't know, the soul looks... I always get into trouble speaking about lawyers. Half of the crowd is lawyers. Speaking about doctors, half of them are doctors. Speaking about drug dealers, all of them are drug dealers. Very good. Oh, we waited for you. Now we can start. Very good. When the soul goes out of the body, exit the body... You'll be famous now. When the soul exits the body, it looks exactly like the body. There's only one difference. If you touch the body, you hear noise. Why you hear noise? Because it's material. Two material collides. That's why you hear noise. But when you try to punch your friend after he dies, you go like this to his soul, you can go back and forth until tomorrow, it's like nothing, it's air. It's there. You don't really see it. Your eyes cannot see spiritual images. I will explain soon why. But the dogs can see, the cats can see. But you cannot touch him, as you're going to understand soon. There are five things we're going to speak about in the next hour. One is out-of-body experience. Two, seance, communication with dead people, receiving information from them. Three, reincarnation, a person that his soul is traveling in different generations, in different bodies. Just to let you know, almost all of us, probably all of us, all the people in the world almost, been here already in different bodies before. There's hardly any new souls coming to the world. It's all souls that visited here in different bodies. Then the fourth subject tonight is regression. Hypnotizing people and getting information out of their soul, who they used to be in their previous life, how they died, what they used to do. You'll be very surprised for what I'm going to show you. I have two or three very beautiful, interesting clips to show you, films that from television, from very famous television, cable television. One of them is about a person who died and his body was finished, but actually came back to life and he wrote a book about it. He was interviewed on television. And the second one, you don't want to miss it, so even if your babysitter only agreed to stay 2 hours, give her double pay. Don't miss the second clip. Is a kid, 2 years old, that remember his entire previous life, and wait until you see the shocking film. Just for that, it was worth for you to come. I show this film in places people cannot move from the chair after. All right. The reason I tell you now, in case you were thinking to run away, now you're stuck. That's it. Curiosity has a good side into it. Then the fifth one, only if I have time, is an unwelcome visitor coming to visit inside your body, what we call dibuk. Two souls in one body. One supposed to be there. Shh. Oh, who's talking here nonstop? She doesn't speak English?
We're very excited.
No, I thought you're translating to her. Huh? You want me to speak Persian?
No.
For you, I'm going to try. Anyway, so a visitor entering your body one day, and all of a sudden, two people living in one body. 1 minute you speak Persian, a minute later you speak Russian. The Russian wants to do something, the Persian wants to eat Gandhi, the Russian wants to eat something else. They're fighting. It's not a joke. This is exactly how it is. The Persian wants to go to the synagogue to pray, the Russian wants to go to the casino now. or the other way around, depends. So, what are you going to do? You have only two pairs of legs. They're fighting. Two captains on one boat. One supposed to be there, it's you, God put you here. Second one, accidentally or not, depend, enter your body and doesn't want to come out. Why? He's very safe inside. Outside is not, inside is a shelter for him. But there's ways to get him out. But usually I don't get to that part. Let's try. What is death? It's a famous question. Until this moment, nobody knows 100% how to define death. There's arguments between the doctors, arguments between the judges in Supreme Courts, in governments, in the United States Congress, among the rabbis, among the priests, the qadis. Nobody knows 100% how to define the moment of death. Why? Because according to the Torah says very simple. What's death? Lechol asher neshama be'apo. Everyone that has breath in his nose, in his nostrils, is alive. Everyone who cannot breathe on his own is dead. Very simple. In the time of the Torah, there was no other options. You either alive because you breathe, you don't breathe, you're dead. That's it. You don't need to know that much. Brain, heartbeat, nobody need to go into that. However, since the world became very sophisticated and they invented all kinds of equipment that can artificially pump air and oxygen into your brain and into your body, into your system, and actually revive you every second and extend your life, we became very confused. Why? Because according to the Torah, this person is dead. Once you disconnect the machine, he's dead in 1 minute. But thanks to the machine, he could be alive another month or two. So what is he really now? Alive or not? What's the difference? If he's alive, you're not allowed to take his heart and plant it by somebody else. If he's dead, why not? Save somebody else's life. Take it, he's dead already. Take his heart and give it to somebody else. You're not really killing him. That's why it's a very complicated issue. That's not the reason. I don't want to go into it. It's very complicated. But one thing everyone agree. Rabbis, priests, doctors, scientists, parapsychologists. Everyone agree on one point. What is it? If the person has no heartbeat, no brain waves, no oxygen going into the organs and into the brain, later, moments after a drop in the temperature of the body, and the fifth symptom, maybe something cold, maybe. And the fifth symptom is no feelings. Someone is burning him with a cigarette or electric, he doesn't feel anything. Those are the five symptoms that once a person has all five, everyone, with no exception, agreed this is a dead person. For how long? If it happens for 10 seconds, it's no big deal. He can come back to life. 10 seconds, he's up. He opens up his eyes. It's no problem. He can still remember everything. More than 6 minutes, he's considered a complete deceased person. That's it. He's dead. In the old days, until a few years ago, right away, they take them to the refrigerator until their funeral. 6 minutes. All these symptoms exist. They cover their head. They take him into the refrigerator, someone comes to recognize them, to identify them, and at burial. However, every rule has an exception to the rule, and there could be an exception to the rule that a person is dead more than 6 minutes, believe it or not, he doesn't have no brain waves, no pulse, no breath, nothing. No feelings, you can burn him with a cigarette. And 20 minutes later, he comes back to life, he sees his entire body is burned. He sees everything you did to him. You're already ready to take his heart out. He said, don't jump too fast, brother. I'm still here. Don't count your millions. Your father is back. Oh, I'm so happy you came back, Dad. Anyway, That's a bad joke. Anyway, let's see some of the names I'm using in this lecture. Thank you. And everything that they discovered. One of the most famous in the world, Dr. Raymond Moody, a psychiatrist from Virginia University, interviewed 150 people who died and came back to life. He wrote books that were published in 30 different languages. The psychologist Carlos Ossif interviewed 877 doctors, described what their patients had, out-of-body experience, clinical death, published their conclusion in a book that called The Time of the Death, and many, many scientific articles. Dr. Kenneth Ring, as you can see, none of them is Jewish. You can see the names. So don't suspect that it's a Jewish conspiracy. The rabbis made it up. You know, it's all goyim, non-religious people. And as you can see right away, professor, a psychologist from Connecticut University, Dr. Kenneth Ring, investigate 102 cases of clinical death and publish a book, The Life in the Death. Dr. George Ritchie, the president of the Medical Richmond Academy and the head of the psychiatrist unit in Towers Hospital, wrote books and articles about his research. The most famous in the world is Dr. Elizabeth Kovler-Ross, a world-known psychiatrist from Detroit. She investigated for 20 years, more than 1,000 cases of people who died and came back to life. She wrote many books and articles, and she's, as I said, considered the top in this industry. Dr. Maurice Rawlings, a cardiologist from Tennessee University, had researched 300 people who died and came back to life and published his books. Dr. Fran Schoonmaker, a main cardiologist in Denver Hospital, more than 1,000 cases. There are many, many others. It's enough, I think, 10 top world known. It's pretty convincing. How many people experience out-of-body experience, clinical death? How many people? Just in the United States alone, 8 million people reported that they died and later came back to life. Just that you understand. If 8 million bother to go to the doctor and tell him what they had and they write it down and they record them and, you know, guess just how many had it and didn't bother with that. Came back to life. They were excited for a few hours. And they moved out, moved back with their business. They made a party, you know. There's a question, what happened now? Does he have to get remarried to his wife or not? Because she was the widow for an hour. According to the Torah, it's a very big question. Because at that moment, his wife, if she was... She said, Baruch Sheptaranu, finally I'm a free woman. Right away she called her boyfriend, let's get married now, I'm a free woman. The guy comes with his 15 carat diamonds, they all make a party, they dancing, the guy shows up. What do you do according to the Torah? That's another lecture. Big problems. Because according to the Torah, his brother needs to have, if he didn't have children, he has to be Me'avim, his wife. What's going to be now? Big, big question. Anyway, we go back. 30 million people in the world reported clinical death and they came back to life. What are the elements that happened to these people from the moment that they died in a car crash, in a heart attack, or in any kinds of death? This is what they all say. Now remember, this is mutual elements to all kinds of people, male, female, all ages, different cultures, different languages, different countries. Nobody knows about the other. This is information that were gathered all over the world. And when you begin to listen to the description of each one of them, it's like a repeat of all the others. All of them are saying the same story, what happened to them from the time they died until they opened up their eyes again. What are they saying? First thing is the soul exit the body in seconds. Somebody shot him, he felt the pain for about 2-3 seconds, the body fell on the floor, and right away he feels that actually he's still alive. He looks down, he sees body with blood on the floor, people are screaming, he see police, he see everything that happens. Where is he? An energy is flying above his body. He's able to hear, he's able to see, he has no more limitation, no distance limitation, nothing. He sees everything. The soul slowly, slowly rising. If it's in a room, after a few minutes, he sees that he's on top of the ceiling. Like a paper that you fly in the air, how the paper is flying like this, this is how he feels. Then they begin to see that they are entering a dark tunnel, a round tunnel with circles, and they begin to fly in the middle, and they begin to fly faster and faster. The more they are flying, they begin to hear a whistle, a ring, and the ring is becoming stronger by the minute. After moments, they begin to see lights. In the beginning, it's completely dark, but after a few moments, they begin to see lights. Moments after, the lights become very, very, very strong. They said, all of them with no exception, that all their life, they never saw such an amount of light in any other place in this world. And not only that it's a huge light and it covers you from all over, strong, bright light, it does not blind the person. The person is able to look into it and he has the most great feelings he ever felt in his entire life. He doesn't remember such a high feeling like those moments that he is directing into this light. Then they see that the light starting to communicate with them. How is the communication done? Through telepathy. Whatever you want to say, you hear right away. You don't have lips. You don't have cords that you can talk. It's the brain talking. It's the soul. The brain is the soul. You communicate with the light. The light asks them questions. They answer. And soon you're going to see word by word what they describe. They felt that there's huge love between them and this light. They are anxious for this light. Then they begin to see their relatives are coming to communicate with them. Grandmothers, brothers, parents, children who died, lo aleinu. They beginning to see people from the school, people from their neighborhood, people from their family that passed away sometimes many, many years before, are starting to show up in their images exactly like they remember them from this life. Then the last thing that they describe so far is that they begin to see all their life in fast chronological order pictures, not a film, pictures from the time there were babies crawling on the rug until the moment of the accident, millions of pictures. One after the other, in such speed, there's no way to describe how fast it is. Which means, if a person is 7 years old, how many pictures you need from the time he was born until now? Millions of pictures to show all his life in pictures. They say that at that moment, they have no limitations in their brain. Everything they see, they're able to understand. Even the smallest details in each picture, even though the pictures are running so fast, they are able to record and understand everything without any limitation of time, of understanding. I need more time, please show it to me again. No. It's mamash clear, 100%. Jews and non-Jews reporting the same things. All of them with no exception at the time that they felt that they're very close to their body in the time of their accident, or if they were moved into a hospital, even though they're already entering the tunnel and they're beginning to communicate with the light, but at the same time, They are able to see everything that happens next to their body. Police, ambulance, another doctor is coming, the wife is crying on the floor. They see everything. So basically, they are able to see two places simultaneously, with no limitation. Gets better. If they're in a hospital, in the first floor, which is the emergency room, later when they open up their eyes 20 or 30 minutes later, sometimes hours later, believe it or not, they describe every detail that you can ask them about in the entire hospital. Even though they never went to the seventh floor, you can ask them, tell me each room on the seventh floor, who is there? Who is sick there, man or woman? What's the clothing over there? What's on the table? Everything they are able to tell. They can tell you things inside the walls. For instance, if God forbid it happens to a person here, when he comes back to life, he will be able to tell you what's above the ceiling. Which wires are disconnected. If the builder wrote something on a sheetrock from the other side, obviously nobody can see it. You have to cut it to see it. But they are able to see it because they go through the walls. Because remember, it's a divine energy, it's not a body. Body cannot go through. Once a soul, he goes through the walls. There is no limitation. Goes into water, he goes to anything he wants. How these people were able to describe all these details when they had no pulse, no brain waves, no breath, no feelings, no nothing. And they still are able to later tell you the entire thing that happens around the hospital. Here is some of the words they have to say. I was up. I saw how they work on my body. I saw they connected the electric shocks to my chest. I saw how my body is jumping. At that moment, I felt I'm falling heavily into my body, back into it. And I opened up my eyes. I knew I'm dying, but there's nothing I could do about it. Nobody helped me. I exit my body. There's no doubt about it. I saw my body laying in a surgery room. I heard the doctors are giving up on my life. I felt horrible. I didn't want to die. Another person. I was out of my body, but I knew clearly that there's still a chance to return, or I can remain there. One of the two options. All of them, as I say, describe the cave, the dark caves in the beginning, the whistle that they hear in their ears, flying in this valley, dark valley, great feelings, until the light shows up. I was out of my body. In the beginning, I felt very bad. Then came that huge light. And I felt warm and great. It did not bother me. I was still able to see everything around me. The doctor, the nurses, the hospital, everyone. I felt communicating with this light. It's full of mercy. I was in front of this light. I felt so good. I didn't want to return. Some of them, that they felt that there is a line between them and the light. And it's obvious to everyone there. Once you cross that line, there is no return. But as long as you didn't cross the line, there is still a chance to return to this material world. Suddenly I saw the light. How to describe? It covered me from everywhere, but did not blind me. The light asked me, "Are you ready to die?" I had a feeling that I'm speaking to a person. But it wasn't a person. It was the light that spoke to me. I knew that the light knows that I'm not ready to die. I had a feeling like I'm getting tested. I felt so great, confidence and love, how to describe. All of them, as I said, described their relatives and friends that came to them. It was all people I knew in my life that passed away. I saw my grandmother. I saw a girl from my school. I saw their faces. I saw they are very close to me. I felt the presence of my relatives and friends flying around me. I felt like they came to welcome me. I saw my friend in my brain, not in my physical body, but clearly his image, his hands, his legs, everything. Let's watch this.
Personal story segment time begins.
Now I need a microphone. Where is it?
We die. Is there an afterlife? Obviously a vital question. Most Americans believe there is. According to an ABC News poll, 90% of them say death is not the end. Certainly wasn't for Don Piper, who was pronounced clinically dead after a car crash back in 1989. Mr. Piper was even put in a body bag. What happened after that is an amazing tale chronicled in his best-selling book, 90%
No. One. Ah, what's happened to the body? One. Maybe this. Huh? Yeah. One. Here.
Personal story segment time. We get a special two-part series about what happens after we die. Is there an afterlife? Obviously a vital question. Most Americans believe there is. According to an ABC News poll, 90% of us say death is not the end. Certainly wasn't for Don Piper, who was pronounced clinically dead after a car crash back in 1989. Mr. Piper was even put in a body bag. What happened after that is an amazing tale chronicled in his best-selling book, 90 Minutes in Heaven. I spoke with Mr. Piper a few days ago. So, Mr. Piper, you're driving down a narrow lane, you see a tractor trailer coming dead at you, pick it up from there.
Well, I was hit head on. I had no idea. It was a narrow highway. I had nowhere to go. I'm on a bridge. He hits me head on with such impact that the wheels of the driver's side of the truck roll over my car, crush me in it, shove it up against the railing of the bridge, and I'm killed instantly.
Now, when you say you were killed, you're sitting here.
Yes.
So, I mean, what's the definition of you being killed?
Well, it was a full-frontal pileup, so four sets of EMTs came out to the bridge location to check on everybody. Everybody else was fine except me, so they all focused on me, and they all did all the tests at their disposal. They all concluded the same thing. I was a fatality. The body was covered up with a waterproof tarp because it was raining, and they waited for someone to come and take the body away.
All right, so you were actually covered head to toe, no breathing hole or anything here or there.
No.
So you're, according to these medical people, done. Then what happens in your mind? What's going on in your mind?
Well, immediately I was standing at some magnificent gates surrounded by people I had known and loved in life. So when I saw them, I knew where I was because I knew where they were. I knew I was at the gates of heaven.
Now, when you saw people that you had known who had passed away before you, were they in human form, body form?
In a sense, they were. They were all fully recognizable as themselves. So, yes, they were tangible. I could see them. And they were all perfect. Many of them I had known in life had died at an elderly age, or maybe they had a traumatic accident themselves. But when I saw them, they were all ageless.
But you say in your book you didn't see God or Jesus or anybody like that.
In the distance, as I was approaching the gate, I'm often asked about this, as you might imagine, there really are a lot of magnificent structures inside the gate. And at the pinnacle of a great hill beyond them is a bright light. I have a distinct feeling that that is where God, and I was headed in that direction when suddenly I was returned to Earth.
Now, how did that happen? You were returned to Earth how? What do you remember?
All I remember is being at the gates and about to enter after a lot of other magnificent things that I saw and heard. As it turns out, 90 minutes after the truck hit me, a man climbed into the car, and because he felt like God spoke to him, he started praying over me even though he knew I was dead. Suddenly I found myself back in the car, under the tarp, in the dark. He's singing a hymn, and he's making me sing it with him, and I had no idea what had happened to me.
What about a doctor or a scientist, somebody saying to you, look, you had a head trauma, and when you have a head trauma, all things, and you were a believer from the jump, I mean, very religious man, this was in your mind, head trauma, hallucinations, it's real to you, but it isn't really real.
Well, it's actually the most real thing that's ever happened to me. It now defines my reality here. I know that how temporary this is. I mean, we know none of us gets out of this life alive.
Well, I guess the bottom line is, if somebody doesn't believe you, and some people watching right now are not going to,
Is there anything you can do or say to make them believe?
This is a very remarkable, unique situation. I saw things there that I wouldn't have expected to see if I was having a dream. I saw people there that I didn't expect to see. There were a lot of things about my experience that convinced me in no uncertain terms that that is reality, and this is fleeting, this is passing. I can't wait to go back there. I didn't want to come back here. Describe it.
Okay, as you saw,
started to walk.
Oh, no. All right. Let's see one of the non-Jews had to say when he came back. I was very embarrassed of what I saw over there. They showed me what I've done wrong. I thought to myself, I wish I wouldn't have done those things. I wish I could return and correct them. Major disappointment that I did not achieve anything in my life. I did not do anything valuable. I didn't know anything. I did not complete one thing in my life. This is a non-Jew. This is his feelings when he came back. Another woman, I made a turn with my car. The car flipped over and explode. I lost my conscious. Minutes after, I was flying inside Be'er Sheva Hospital, the hospital that you saw now on the news in the south in Israel when all the wounded people were going there. That's the hospital she's describing. I never saw it before, but now I know everything about it. I lost sense of time and space. I saw everything simultaneously. I was in all the rooms in 1 minute. I saw myself on the bed, then I saw the emergency room, then I saw a room in a hospital, and now she begins to describe in the third floor a tennis shoe by the window. They go up to the third floor in the hospital. They ask them, excuse us, we want to check something. They open the window, and guess what? A white tennis shoe by the window. The only way to see it, it's from outside of the building. You couldn't see it from the hospital. You had to see it from the outside, which means the soul was able to see things on the outside of the building. When she was actually dead in the first floor, in the hospital. Another woman said, one nurse was trying to give me breath to save my life. I looked at her neck while she's trying to revive me, and then I saw they connecting the electric into my chest, the shocks. I saw my body jumping. I heard every bone in my body is moving. But she is actually not inside the body until she returns and opens up their eyes. Now comes the shocking news. What's the shocking news? A person that never saw colors in his eyes, a blind person, never saw colors. He was born blind. He's 20, 30 years old now. How many years is going to take each one of us to describe him the color blue? You want to teach a blind person what blue is. How many years is going to take you? Forever. No matter what you're going to do, you will never be able to put inside his brain the knowledge what blue is, or black, or brown. Why? He never saw those colors. You open up his eyes for 1 second, you show him blue, you close it again, then he knows blue for the rest of his life. He doesn't have to see it ever again. It's in the computer, it's recorded. But since he never know colors, he never saw colors, you can try to do, you tell him it's like the sky. What is the sky? It's like green. What's green? No matter what you're going to say, he's not going to understand what you're talking about. Why? In his computer, there's no colors. How is it possible that blind people, Dr. Elizabeth Kobler-Ross, the top parapsychologist in the world, she's asking these questions. After reviewing 1,000 cases of out-of-body experience, some of them were blind. How is it possible that a blind person that was dead for 10-15 minutes, when he came back to life, he described everything in a hospital in colors? How is it possible if he never saw colors in his life? Now we are understanding here two fantastic things. One, that the limitation of the blind people, it's not from their soul. The soul always see everything. The limitation is that the blinds of the window are closed. Open the blinds and you can see outside. When you are inside a room and the blinds are closed, or the shades, you cannot see what's outside. Why? You can see, but your face is black. Open the blinds and you'll be able to see outside. I am inside this room, it's like the soul inside the body. When the soul inside the body, the soul can see to all direction. Why the soul can see only forward? Because the blinds are only here. That's why it's black from the back and it's black from here. For instance, if it was able to create two holes here with eyes, take eyes and instead of here, move them to here, then you would see from the side. Because the soul always see. It's just that the soul is black from here. And it can see only forward. But when a soul gets out of the body completely, the soul can see to all directions with no limitation. Same thing hearing, same thing, all kinds of things that happen around simultaneously, it can record everything with no memory problems. However, we still have to explain. If we open up the eyes of a blind person right now in a miracle, he still wouldn't know what blue is. If we show him now colors, choose which color you like for your kitchen. What's their names of all these colors? He will point at the yellow and think it's white. He will point at the blue, he will guess it's black. He never saw them. How is it possible that these people that died were able to recognize colors? The doctor has gray hair. The nurse has blonde hair. The ceiling is mahogany. How do they know? They never saw in their lifetime colors. The answer is from previous reincarnation. When the soul exits the material, the limitation, it remembers all his lifetimes. And he remembers everything from different lives, as I'm going to prove to you soon. But it's very interesting. When he's alive, he's blind. Take his soul out of his body, he can see everything. Very interesting. So, the conclusion so far, I'm skipping a little bit because time is running out, but so far, the conclusion for the first level of this lecture is Dr. Elizabeth Kovler-Ross, I know beyond any doubt, life continues after the physical death. Those who are open to hear can hear, and those who block their ears will be very surprised. No doubt whatsoever, there's life after death. Dr. Kenneth Ring, I believe we remain after our physical death. A conclusion, there is a divine energy, a spiritual energy in the body of each human being that remains alive after the body was eaten completely by the worms. The person is still alive somewhere. Where? We're going to understand soon. So far it was all science. I did not mention the Torah except the first two minutes of the lecture. Let's see what Judaism had to tell us about everything those parapsychologists work very hard to find. You saw 20 years, 10 years, 1,000 cases, 877. This is not a minute or two. This is years of research from morning to night with lots of money. Everything they discovered, if they only knew a little Gemara and Torah and Zohar, it would save themselves all this work. But Baruch Hashem, they don't know. So we use what they found to show you scientific proof that our Torah that we receive from the Creator of the world already told us all these things free of charge. Just open and read. Let's see what the Torah had to say. I start with the Gemara in Masechet Psachim. Rabbi Yosef, the son of Rabbi Yoshua, became sick. and his spirit left him. He died. When he came back to life, his father told him, "What did you see in the world of truth?" He told him, "I saw everything the opposite from here. Those who are important here are nothing over there. And those who are neglected over here, nobody gives them the highlights. They are very, very precious over there." So his father told him, "No, that's the truth. It's not the opposite. Here it's the opposite. Over there it's real. Over here you can have $1 billion. But when you come in front of God, you don't know where to hide from your embarrassment when you review your life. And a person that have $1.50 in his bank account, he comes there like a king. Let him go. It's an angel came. He's more important than me. I own half of New York." "Who gave you New York?" "I gave it to you. You too, you get it? You got it? I gave it to you. I gave you money. I gave him money, I gave you. I decided to give you a lot because your test is different than his. That's the only reason. Not because you're a genius or something." How many fools have so much money, and how many genius people with master degrees hardly pay the rent? Money, it's not an indication of anything. Not wisdom, not strength, not talent, no nothing. And those who think that this is the case, they disagree with King Solomon, the smartest person ever lived. They have a serious debate here. It's not me. King Solomon wrote, "Lo lachachamim lechem." Wisdom does not bring parnasa. I once met a guy in Flatbush Avenue. He owned 20 sneaker stores. He doesn't know to write his name in English. 20 years is in America. And I thought to myself, look at me, I'm a genius compared to him. I don't have $2. And look at this guy. Then I realized that whatever you are, it's what God gave you. But let's move on. And the boy say one more thing. The boy said, "I heard an echo over there." What is the echo that he heard? "Ashrei mi sheva lekan v'talmudo beyado." How lucky are the ones who comes here with knowledge in their hands. Which knowledge? They have 2 degrees from Columbia and Yale. So God is clapping for them. Please accept him. Look, this doctor, this psychiatrist, this mathematician. Please, oh, Avraham Avinu, please, let them come in. That's not what the Torah meant. This is before Harvard. This was written 2,000 years ago. Ashrei mi sheba lepo betalmudo beyado. Who is a talmid chacham that knows Torah is lucky here. And those who are ignorant have a serious problem. Then another, Zohar. Zohar is Kabbalah, for those who didn't know. Rabbi Krospadai, they thought he died. They check his pulse, they check his breath, he's dead. Then he came back to life. And he says, he described his soul elevated to the upper worlds and the beginning of his trial. According to the Torah, when a person dies, his soul leaves the body and slowly, slowly goes up to the court of heaven. How long is the trial? 1 year. That's why we say Kaddish on the deceased people for 1 year. It's not coincidence. Everything has a deep reason. Why we say Kaddish for them? We want to help them out in their trial. Most of us are not righteous, and we need help. And therefore, when our relatives say Kaddish, after we leave this world, they are helping to elevate the soul. Now, the Zohar says, this is another thing from the Zohar, when the soul, I want to show you now that everything that they say, it's exactly like the Torah says. When the soul leaves the body in this life, it enters the cave, Me'arat HaMachpelah. You know Me'arat HaMachpelah? Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov are buried there in Hebron. Every soul enters Me'arat HaMachpelah, that cave. From there, it's the entrance to the upper world. All 3 days after the death, the soul is flying above the body. 3 days. and hoping to return into it. This was written more than 2,000 years ago. Make no mistake. 7 days the soul is traveling back and forth from the house into the cemetery. Back and forth. After 7 days, no more permission for the person to see this world ever again, with some exceptions. But that's it. He leaves permanently this place. Apart from his soul, remains in a grave forever until the resurrection of the dead, if he will have the merit to resurrect. Depends who he is. Not everyone will resurrect. It depends who you are. That's why in Judaism, some people go to graves of tzaddikim and pray over there. What, they talk to the wall? For what? They came to the piece of marble over there, hey, help me out. They pray for the righteous person over there to bring their prayer directly to God. Since you're a great lawyer, you're a righteous person, the judge loves you over there. Please help me out in court. Hey, Mr. Attorney, you know the judge, talk to him. That's why they go to the grave. Really, it's a waste of time. Because God is everywhere. And you can scream to him as much as you want, and if you're gonna just have one or two drops of tears, it goes express directly to the judge, but that's a different topic. All these things you can watch in my website. I have about 400 lectures over there in all the topics you can think of, in English, in Hebrew, divineinformation.com. You can see all the lectures over there. Rabbi Dosa says, Ki lo irani ha'adam v'chai. A person cannot see me and stay alive. Nothing is harder to the soul more than the separation from the body. And a person cannot die until he sees the lights of God. Remember, this is more than 2,000 years. Before Dr. Raymond Moody and Dr. Kovler-Ross were born, the Torah already told us everything they found. And out of anxiety and passion to this great light, his soul exits the body towards that light. When a time for a person came to die, his soul gets out of the body and he sees the Spirit of God. Out of happiness to see it, he comes out of his body. If he's righteous, he is merited to get connected to this light. If not, after a short while, the light will disappear and he stay to mourn over his death and the separation from his body. The Zohar says, in a time of the dead, a person gets permission to see all the things he could not see in his life. Why Rachel didn't want to marry me? Why my partner stole all my money? My white children did not become lawyers as I dreamed? Why I missed the plane? My wife, why my friend took my ticket and got on a plane and the plane crashed? What merit I had to get saved? What happened to all my donations that I gave? How many Jews it saves in the world? What happened from all my Lashon Hara? How many people lost their life because of me? Everything a person seen is trial, everything. Every penny you put in a box, you don't think about it. You put a dollar in a box. Tomorrow somebody asks you, remember you put a dollar yesterday in a box? I put a dollar in a box? I don't remember. 7 years later, God shows you, you see that dollar that you put, or $5? The rabbi took it, and he made with this $5 five DVDs. That's what it cost, $1 to make. Those five DVDs he gave to five different non-religious Jews. Two out of the five took it serious. They continued, they went into the website, they listened to lectures every 2-3 days. Slowly, slowly, after 3-4 months, they become Shomer Shabbat. It happened to me thousands of times, in case you think I'm making it up. It happens by the minute. Every day, emails, phone calls, I became Shomer Shabbat from the DVDs, I became religious, my father. Every day, phone calls from people, I want you to speak to my father, he just watched the DVD. Two people came today to the yeshiva. When I spoke to them 1 hour in person, I didn't have time, it wasn't enough. Somebody sent them from Ohio to New York. They came to the yeshiva, they didn't know. They didn't have a place to live. No, we didn't come to yeshiva, we came to look for a job. So they went to Brooklyn. Today I came into the yeshiva in the morning, two out of the three came. Why? I gave them DVDs. The person who sponsored the $3 is the luckiest person on earth. Why? Two out of three became religious. Came to yeshiva to learn Torah. Two of them, in 2, 3, 4, 5 years, they could be big rabbis. They can make hundreds of people religious. And their grandparents, grandchildren, and grandchildren forever for $2. What an investment. Better than Bernstein, no? People don't think. When you're ignorant, you don't know where to put your money. Rabbi, I sponsor $5,000 for the party in a shul. Take the $5,000, make 5,000 DVDs, give it to 5,000 Mechalele Shabbat, 100 of them for sure will become Shomer Shabbat. That's it, you're the luckiest guy on earth. No matter how many mitzvot you do in your life, they'll do much more for you. People don't realize. When Olam Abad the Zohar said, everything you did, you see the results of it. Just think how many surprises we're going to have. Then the Torah says, Olam Haba is wide. No edges. No limits. No ceiling. Only huge light. That is nothing compared to the light in this life. So far, word by word of what all these goyim said or no? Everything, no? Goyim or not goyim? Jews and non-Jews. Here is another thing. When a righteous Jew died, Hashem says, God says to the righteous people who already died before, go and make a party for this righteous Jew. Accept him, welcome him. And all the righteous people come, think about it. King David, King Chizkiyahu, Avraham Avinu, Moshe Rabbeinu, Aaron, all these great names. Rambam, they come, they make a party for you. You're welcome. What do they say? Yavo Shalom. Come in peace. When a person died, he gets permission to see his relatives from the material world. And he recognized them, and they look exactly like they used to look in their bodies. Didn't they say it, that they saw their relatives? How did the Torah know all these things? Without Dr. Moody. Huh? Coincidence. Good luck. 20 guesses, bingo. Everything perfect. The Torah knew everything. Accident. Big bang. If he's righteous, they're all happy for him, the relatives. And they walk with him. The Gemara says, Rabban Yochanan ben Zakkai says, moments before he died, to his student, bring a chair quickly. Chair? For what chair? He's dead in bed soon. King Chizkiyahu, the king of Judah, is coming to welcome me. Bring a chair for him, the king. Where is he? Today, if it happened, what are you going to say? Abba, father, sleep, you're hallucinating. Bring a cold towel. Pull on his head. I have a guy, used to be in yeshiva. He told me what, mama, seconds before his father died. Seconds before his father died. Any message?
Whoever had a Toyota Camry, they left their light on outside.
That's not, I could give them cables, don't worry. It happens to me every 2 days. Anyway, I have a guy in the yeshiva, one time his father was, mamash goses, moments before he's dead. Then he say, what Rivka is doing here? I say, which Rivka? Rivka, the neighbor from downstairs. He see the neighbor from downstairs. He say, wow, you're hallucinating. What's the neighbor? You don't feel good, relax. An hour later he died, and 2 hours later they found out that in a moment that he said, what is Rivka doing here? The neighbor from downstairs died that moment. Her soul was going up, he saw it. Why? Because he was half alive, half dead already. His energy was leaving the body. He was able to see things. And this is exactly like the Zohar says. In a time for a person alive to die, God shows him all his life. Every deed, every step that he made in his life, he sees. And they tell him, and he say to him, this is what you did in that day. Do you confirm it? And he say, of course, God. And God comes to him and say, I want you to sign on everything you did in your lifetime. This is now the time for you to die. And he signs and confirms. And this is what the Torah say, Da malemala mimcha. Always know, there's an eye who watch over you. There's an ear who listens to everything that you say. And everything you do is being registered in the book of God. Pirkei Avot, chapter 2, verse 1. Let's see something else the Gemara had to say. The Gemara in Masechet Shabbat, page 152. Everything you say in front of the dead person, he knows. Until the grave is covered with the sand. Which means, God forbid, hopefully you never have to be in a funeral. But remember this, if you ever have to be in a funeral, everything the people do next to the grave, his spirit, he sees everything. Until when? Once they cover him with sand, he cannot see anymore. But he can still see a little bit until the worms finish to eat the entire flesh, the skin, everything, and it's only bones left in a grave. That's when a person has no communication with this world ever again. But as long as he's still complete in a grave, still have some kind of connection. I don't know how to explain it. It's very hard to explain. But this is what the Torah says. Amar Rav to Shmuel, Bar Shilat. Two rabbis learning 2,000 years ago in Babylon. When I die, I want you to make me a respectable eulogy. Say all the great things that I did in my life. Charity, teaching Torah, whatever. Why? Why do you want to brag? What do you care? You'll be dead already. What do you care? No. Because I will be right there and listen to your words. So what do you see? That everything that they found, the Torah already told us. Why did you have to bother so much? The Torah say, death is not the end. A person is there and he hears everything over there. Now, I'm moving into the second part, which is medium. Medium, seance. Communication with dead people and asking them questions. One famous, what is a medium? You take a middleman, and there are people who are able to focus, they fall asleep, they like fainted. And you begin to ask questions from a dead person, and the dead spirit is giving information through this middleman. How do you know the dead person is really answering and not him? Maybe she's making it up. Very simple. She doesn't know your life story. She doesn't know the secrets between you and your father. If your father tells you, hey, I put $1 million in the backyard next to the tree, how does she know? You go tomorrow, you dig, you see $1 million. She knows? She doesn't know you. You just met her 2 minutes ago. You go to communicate. Jews are not allowed to do it. It's very risky. But there are two famous mediums. One named Leonora Pfeiffer and the other one Eileen Gart. Leonora Pfeiffer from Boston, famous medium, connected between the deceased people and their relatives. For 40 years, seven groups of investigators were following her, checking her, confusing her on purpose. Nobody could understand how this woman knows the secret of all these families. And the final conclusion was, she has ability to communicate with dead people that most people don't have it. And she gives authentic information. And the dead person is telling you exactly what you're asking him. Why you did this, why you didn't give me the house, why do you give the house to your sister, it's not fair, I changed your diapers before you died, it's not fair. You can ask him everything, but it's not permitted for Jews to do. Then I have to skip some of the things because I have beautiful mediums that she had in 1877 and all kinds of things that maybe in another time you'll be able to see. But let's just give one example from what she said. Somebody asked to speak to his friend from school, and then she begins to describe. He is a friend from you from childhood. She named him. He said you used to walk every day to school together. You used to jump like frogs and make jokes. And he was much better than you. And then he's upset at you that just before he died, you were not there. You understand? So she was able to give exact information. One time they brought 150 people to a seance. 30 from them knew George Folio. This is who they're going to communicate. All of a sudden he started to speak to 30 out of the 150 people in the crowd and ask them personal questions. She went to a guy, hey, your name is XYZ. He wants to know why you did such and such. He asked you if you remember that you went together with him to a movie. 30 out of 50, she knew to call them, which one, because he was telling her. But he's there and he gives information. Let's move forward because I have bombastic things to show you. There is automatic writing. What's automatic writing? Automatic writing is something very, very interesting. What is it? The medium is actually asleep. She's not in a conscious. She's asleep. The head is down. How does she hold the pen? Not like a normal person. She holds the pen like this. And she's asleep. And then after moments, you begin to speak to a dead person and you see the pen begins to move on the paper. And he writes things. And then you take what it writes and you see what the dead person wants you to hear. Communication through writing. Pay attention to this. The American medium, Rosemary Brown. She has no knowledge in music whatsoever. When she writes music, she writes music of Chopin, Brahms, Bach, Beethoven, the most famous classical musicians. How does she know? How does she know? She doesn't know music. She never went to school. Why? Because in the middle of the seance, Mozart comes and moves her hand. Beethoven comes and moves her hand. It's very interesting. Emma Conti, an Italian woman, she's also a medium. She receives songs from the spirit of Emily Dickinson. She was a famous songwriter, Emily Dickinson. She won 46 awards for her writing, even though she never even went to high school. Complete ignorant farmer, Italian. She closed her eyes. Her hands is moving and she win all the awards. Let's talk about reincarnation. Get ready. Hold the chair tight. As I say to you, the soul is being here in different bodies. All of you, basically, technically, can find out who you used to be in your previous life. Where you used to live, what was your job, who was your wife, how many children you had, how did you die. It's all possible, and it's very simple. How? You go to a parapsychologist. Doesn't have to be religious, as long as you know how to return you back to conscious. Some people know how to hypnotize you, but they don't know how to bring you back. So you stay like this for 50 years. It's very interesting, hypnotizing people. Shh. And through hypnotizing people, hypnosis, you are going to be amazed some of the things that can be found. Let's first describe. 500 years ago, there was a rabbi, his name is Rabbi Yehuda Arye Mimodina, a rabbi and a doctor in Italy, from Venice. He did not believe in reincarnation. Everyone who spoke about it didn't want to hear. Until one time his neighbor called him, "Rabbi, come quick. There's a 6-month-old baby dying next door to him." The rabbi came and he saw that the kid is any moment is going to die. 6 months old, baby. He started to read Tehillim and words of Torah as the baby is dying. Second before the baby died, he opened up his eyes and said, Shema Israel, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, and he died. 6 months old baby, in Hebrew, in Italy. Rabbi was shocked and he wrote in his book, from now on, I don't have to believe in reincarnation, I saw in my eyes. How as a baby knows to speak if he's only 6 months old? Nobody ever spoke to him Hebrew in Italy. It happened also to the Goyim in Portugal. One baby opened up his eyes before he died and screamed, Viva Juan something, name of a Portuguese king. And about a month or two after, this person became the king of Portugal. But the baby already died. But he already announced his name. A baby. How is a baby talking? Now let's see scientific evidence to reincarnation. And the film is just about to come. Be more patient. The most compelling evidence of reincarnation gathered Dr. Ian Stevenson, a psychiatrist and a parapsychologist from Virginia University. From the 60s until today, for about 50 years, Dr. Stevenson checked 600 reincarnations all over the world. And he wrote many books and articles with floods of evidence about reincarnation. This is a typical case of reincarnation. Indika Gonreta, a boy from Sri Lanka, India, was born 1962. Pay attention to the dates. 1962, a boy in Sri Lanka is born. The boy begins to say words that a kid not supposed to know. Words, names of people, they begin to get nervous, his parents. In 1968, that means 6 years after the boy is born, he's 6 years old, first grade, Dr. Stevenson started to investigate this case personally. And he published his conclusion in the newspaper ASPR in 1974. Which means when the boy was 12 years old, he finished his research, his investigation. 6 years he followed that boy every day, every week. And here is his conclusion. Indika started to talk when he was 2 years old. A year after, now he's 3 years old, he described his previous life. Imagine your boy comes to you, 3 years old, Mommy, take me to my wife. Who is your wife, honey? Here, take a lollipop. Leave me alone. You have many, many cases like this. Thousands of cases like this in the world. Kids come to their parents. I want to go visit my house. I miss my children. Take me there. And they describe where they used to live. Wait and see. He says, I used to live in the city of Matara, in Sri Lanka. I had a huge mansion, a Mercedes car, maybe it was Persian. and elephants. No, it wasn't Persian, for sure. Elephants. Elephants in his backyard. He has a servant, Parmadaza, that used to be his private chauffeur. The father of Indika Gonreta checked his son's stories, and he checked in that city, and he found out that he used to be a wealthy guy that lived in Matara, that he is feeding the story of his son exactly. He sent Dr. Stevenson over there. He went to India and Sri Lanka and confirmed some of the things the boy said. Who used to be a businessman that sell trees. His name was K.J. Verizinga. He used to live in Matara. He died in 1960. His servant and the elephants are still in that mansion. But he's in a different place, that boy. But he remembered his house. But the good news is, pay attention to what happened. He died in 1960. And he returned back to life 2 years later in a new body. Shanti was born in Delhi in India in 1926. Age 3, she started telling her parents about the city of Mothra. She said, "My husband, Kaidarnath, and I died when I gave birth to my son 10 days after. When my son was 10 days old, I died after the labor." When Shanti became 9 years old, she was speaking about her previous life clearly. The parents sent a messenger to Mothra and they found that Kaidarnath is still alive. They wrote him a letter about their daughter and her hallucination. Kaidar was very impressed. He saw the details that the girls are saying. One day he showed up suddenly and knocked on their door without telling them. As soon as they opened the door, the girl recognized him right away. And she answered all his questions. What is his favorite food? What she used to cook for him? 9 years old girl. She tells him all their life together before she died. But, wait a minute, it gets better. She said, "I'm very upset and disappointed from you." "Why?" "Why did you get remarried? Didn't we make a deal that we won't get remarried if one of us will die?" And the husband, she's right, this is the deal we made. And then she said to him, they decided that they'll take her to the city of Mothra where Kaidar is alive, where he lives over there. And they remember, this is 1926, there's no cars like today. So they went to a train station. In the train station, from all the people, she recognized his brother-in-law, Gita. Here is Gita, from the previous life. From all the people. Then she gave direction to the carriage, to the horse, to go all the way to the house. Even though they renovated the house and it looked different from the outside, she knew that's the house. She knew every room before they opened the door. And just before they finished, she told him, "I want you to dig right here next to the tree." They began to dig, they brought shovel, they start to dig, and they don't find anything. She looks at him, she says, "Where is the money?" And the embarrassed Kaidar was forced to admit that after her death, he took the money from the place. She hid her money over there, and he took the money. She's dead, why not? He's her husband. So this is a girl that remembers her entire previous life. In Israel, the Arab Druze, have hundreds of cases. It's a small nation, very small, but they have hundreds of people who remember their previous life without hypnosis. That's the interesting part. Hypnosis, every one of us will describe his previous life. But this is without hypnotizing them. Without. And a soldier in the Israeli army from the village of Osfia. One time in exercising, he threw a granite. He's about to throw a granite. He's practicing in the army. And he froze. He felt very strange. He felt that already once a granite like this exploded in his face. He got very scared and he couldn't throw it. He said, "Until 10 years old, I remember my death. Then I started to forget about it. When I went to the Israeli army, it all came back. I did not die as a soldier. I was a shepherd, 18 years old. One time I found a granite on the floor. I opened it up and it exploded in my face and I died when I was 18 years old. It happened on August 14, 1958, when I died. At that day, a kid was born in the next village, Osfia. His name is Badr. In his new life, he's 33 years old. He's working in Haifa port, and he's in the reserve in the Israeli army. He say, when I was a kid, I already knew that my mother is not my real mother. I have a different mother. When I was 5, I told my parents that I used to be a shepherd. I told them where I hid my flute. They went to his previous house. He had a flute that he used to play when he was a shepherd. They found the flute from his previous life. Another Druze, when he was 7 years old, he described his entire previous life. He died in Lebanon. He's also an Israeli soldier. 44 years old, the building in Lebanon collapsed on his head. If you remember, many years ago, they killed more than 70 soldiers. And he described his entire previous life. And now they're showing him sitting with his cousin. The cousin is 44, and he's 7. And remember how he used to go to dance in the nightclub and drink beer? 7 years old. And that they show this in the Israeli television, which is very, very anti-religion, in prime time. And they show him in the end of the article standing next to his grave. And the woman asking him, do you feel bad standing next to your grave? He say, yeah, it's bad. I look at my grave from his previous body, from his previous life. So he's really him, but he remembers his entire previous life. Let's skip some of the things. And where is the microphone? Wait. Let's. No, this permitted. Reincarnation is permitted. We ready for the movie? I'm sorry. For one. Okay, here you go. Okay, shh. Pay attention to this. It's a shocking movie. Please. Just give me volume.
There are thousands of stories like this, and Dr. Jim Tucker has gathered many of them.
No, please. You ready? Here you go. Okay, that should work. That should work now. It takes a few seconds.
There are thousands of stories like this, and Dr. Jim Tucker has gathered many of them.
We're investigating cases of very young children who spontaneously begin talking about previous lives. They usually begin between the ages of 2 and 3 and continue until the age of 5 or 6. We're looking at these cases to learn as much as possible about this phenomenon.
Jim Tucker is preparing a research trip to meet one of his subjects, a child claiming to remember a past life.
Gus Artay is a little boy in Colorado who has talked about being his grandfather. This began when he was 18 months old, and he's made a number of statements that seem quite specific. This one is a stronger case because the child has made some very specific statements that seems very unlikely he could have heard through normal means.
Gus Ortega's case is only one of many.
We've been studying these cases for the last 40 years. We've now collected over 2,700 cases like this. These cases have been found all over in Asia. In West Africa, they've been found in South America, in Europe, and the United States, pretty much wherever they've been looked for.
In a place not quite that far away, a hospital in America, an old man is dying. He is this man reborn. Gus Ortega is a normal 6-year-old. Like most boys, he cherishes his time with his dad. But this relationship is different. Gus remembers that he played with his dad in a previous life. Only then, he was the father. And his dad was his son. This is the case that UVA scientist Jim Tucker is investigating.
Whenever I go to see a case, I go with a certain amount of skepticism. I never go with the assumption that this is reincarnation. And that's also the same approach that I have with the work as a whole. We're here because this is an interesting phenomenon, so we're trying to learn as much about it as possible.
Attention! finished changing Augie's diaper, and that he looked right up at him and said, "You know, Dad, when I was your age, I used to change your diaper."
I was flabbergasted, to be honest with you. I thought it was just kind of strange, especially the choice of words to say that phrase, "When I was your age," for this little 1.5-year-old toddler.
He started talking about Grandpa, and you know, just the little things he was saying that they knew he couldn't have known because he never met Grandpa. His grandfather died a year before he was born. So, we were pretty puzzled about it.
And one day, Ron Ortega brought a set of old photos home, and something even more remarkable occurred.
And I said, "Oh, look, here's a look at this old photograph." And he came up to it and he goes, "Oh, there's me." I mean, I was like just totally astounded, you know. It just stopped me, you know, cold. I mean, because how would he know that?
Gus would make more statements like that over the course of the next years. He would recollect episodes of his grandfather's life that even Ron could hardly remember. And he was there. Gus knew more about his grandfather than he should have. Is this evidence of reincarnation? How else can these children remember another life? The case files of Dr. Jim Tucker will yield more clues.
Okay, so, Baruch Hashem. So you can put the lights back on, please. I think for every intelligent human being, you don't really need more than this. It's a final proof. A little kid remember 2 years old that he used to be the father of his father in previous life. And, you know, he knows details from his previous life that obviously nobody was able to know. And just I have, you know, the lecture is becoming better by the minute. So now the best thing I kept for the end, there's something even better than this. Spiritual pictures. I'm moving into the last part of the lecture, the last 10 minutes, and then if you have questions, I'm going to be happy to answer. Before I will show the pictures, I want to explain what it means. When God created us, created the world, every creation has a purpose. There's a tiger, and there's a cat, and there's a dog, and there's a bird, there's a fly. Everyone has a purpose in the creation. Not always we understand it. Not always we care about it. Some of the things we know, the purpose, oxygen for us to live, water for us to live, food for us. Some of the animals for our use, cows, sheep, we know, horses to ride on them. Some of the things we probably will not understand in our lifetime. But one thing we find very interesting, the brilliance of the Creator is so great that everyone was created in a unique way for Him according to His purpose. That's why we have 5 fingers, we have eyes, we have the brain, we have all kinds of things in our body that helps us to do the mitzvot, and so forth and so on. And then, he gets angry. I don't know where he came from, this microphone. One guy told me, "Rabbi, I'm only angry when people makes me angry. I never get angry just like that." I say, "You fool. Do you know anyone who gets angry if nobody speaks to him? Everyone gets angry when someone makes them angry. If you get angry when nobody got you angry, you need a mental doctor." Anyway, we'll move on. God made us eyes, and our eyes is different than the dog's. It's different than the cat's. It works in different frequency. Why? There are many, many spiritual things around us that we are unable to see. Angels, demons, souls of wicked people that are flying in space for whatever reason, I don't want to go into it. There are many things around us. They're right next to you, but you cannot see it. Why you can't see it? The Zohar, the Kabbalah says that if a Jew was able to see 1 second the things around him, he wouldn't be able to move ever again, go crazy. How do you see them? The Gemara says, you take a black female cat, a daughter of a black female cat, and you take, after you kill the cat, don't do it at home, you know, but after you kill the cat, you take the placenta of that female, you burn it, you take the ashes, you put it on your eyes, you open up your eyes, and guess what? You go crazy in 1 second. Why? Just from the images you see around you in space, you go nuts. One of the rabbis in the Gemara was curious, and he did it. And he became crazy, he couldn't move. All the rabbis came to pray next to him in bed every day. Every day, prayers, minyanim in his house. Until he came back to reality. Why do I tell you this? Because the camera, when we have a digital or regular camera, or sometimes even video cameras, the lens of the camera works in different frequency like the eyes of a person. Sometimes you sit in your room, in your house, in a quiet night, and the cat or the dog, out of nowhere, it's very quiet, all of a sudden jump, crying, getting nervous, moving his tail, running around the house. You look around, you don't understand, what happened to you? Sit down. And he goes crazy, and he looks, and he's running, and he's hiding in a corner. It's like somebody comes to punch him in his face. Why the dog see it and you don't see it? Because you're not supposed to see it. It's going to eliminate your free choice. Zohar says, if the people will see 1 second what happened to the wicked people after they died around, what happened to them? Everybody will run to the yeshiva for the rest of their life. Nobody cares about anything. No business, no wife, no children. Don't get me out of here, Rabbi. I'll pay you, just let me sleep on the floor. Why? I don't want to waste a minute of my life. But that's no free choice. It's out of fear. God was not interested in this. But the dogs and the cats, they can see it. They don't have a free choice. They are not being tested. Also the camera. I'm going to show you soon some of the pictures that cameras detected accidentally. Nobody knew what to look for. You took a picture of your wife. You developed the picture. And you see a man is hugging her in the middle of the picture. But when you took the picture, you remember there was no man. And one woman, it's time for jokes, you know, it's getting scary. Let's break the ice a little bit. One guy wanted to be righteous like Rabbi Akiva. So he read that Rabbi Akiva left his wife 24 years, and he came back after 24 years with 24,000 students. So he told his wife, I'm going to yeshiva for 10 years. Don't worry, not 24 years, only 10 years. I'll see you in 10 years. When I come back, I'll be a great rabbi. 10 years later, he came back home and see his house is full of 10 children. So he said to his wife, who are all these children? He said, they're all my sons. He said, your sons? He said, yeah, you wanted to be a tzaddik, right? What did the Torah say about the tzaddikim? Melechet tzaddikim na'aset bidei acherim. The work of the righteous people are done by other messengers. So you have 10 children. What do you want? I'm going to sit and wait for you. You go be tzaddik somewhere else, my friend. Your wife comes before. Anyway, just before I show you the pictures. It's only a joke. Don't take it serious. Don't get ideas here. Anyway, just before I show you the pictures, one last thing for tonight. I started to tell you about regression. Regression means hypnotizing people and get information out of them while they're asleep. How do you do it? You tell a person, I want you to stare in one dot in the wall for 10 minutes and don't think about anything. Just stare about this. Or sometimes they do it with a clock, you know, with a watch that they move left and right. And slowly, slowly, a person feels that he's falling asleep, and that's it, he loses conscious. He's half asleep. While he's in this situation, you are able to withdraw information, not from him, from his soul, from his subconscious, directly out of his subconscious, which makes it very interesting. Let me explain you how it works. In 1973, a famous doctor in Philadelphia was working with his wife in hypnosis and regression. After he hypnotized his wife, she started to speak in a voice of a man. A man is speaking from her mouth. She's asleep, and now she talks, but it's a man speaking. Not only a man is speaking from her mouth, instead of English, an ancient Swedish, very old language, from Sweden. And only after he recorded all the, you know, the hypnotizing when he was doing with people, he was always filming it, 1973. They brought a world expert to languages to recognize what she said. Nobody knew. And they found out that she used to be a farmer in Sweden exactly 300 years ago, in the 1700s, in a village called Enschien. She described her tools, his tools. He was a man. She was a man in her previous life. Farmer in Sweden 300 years ago, like the Amish. Remember the Amish, if you saw them, how they plow the ground with these old things? She described everything, but she's actually speaking in a language that nobody knows. Dr. William McDougall, a psychologist from Harvard University. McDougall is a world expert in hypnosis. In Oxford, accidentally, when he hypnotized a person, the person suddenly announced that he's an Egyptian carpenter. And he's making an eagle for Pharaoh. How long ago? 3,500 years ago. He's speaking to him, this doctor, and in the middle he says, I'm a carpenter. I was told by Pharaoh to make him an eagle. It gets better. He described the eagle with signs, with a white crown on his head, the eagle. McDougall, you know, he didn't think so much about the importance of this discovery. When did he get the shock? 9 months later, when he found out on the news that Sir Partrey, an English archaeologist that worked in Egypt, just found that eagle, exactly like the guy described in the middle of his hypnosis. Hard to believe. Where is this eagle? In museum in Holland, Leiden Museum. The eagle is there, and he found out who made the eagle 3,500 years ago. So that means this guy, his previous reincarnation wasn't like us. Most of us probably 100 years ago, 50 years ago. You don't really know. It was 3,500. Where was he for 3,500 years ago? In the bank of the souls. There's a place called Tohu in Shamaim. All the souls that are waiting for another chance to correct their soul, reincarnation, Jews and non-Jews, are waiting on hold. Sometimes when you hypnotize a person, this is how it works. There are a lot of films about it. It's very, very scary because the way the people, woman talks with the man's voice, or the other way around, is mamash shocking. You get goosebumps all over your body when you see it. And sometimes it's mamash in different languages. But the shocking thing is that as this is an example of one hypnosis that they did to a woman. In the middle, she's an old woman. You know, she's an American woman. She speaks in English. And then they say, let's go, let's say, 10 years back in the date. Now she speaks a little bit younger. Then they go 20 years. Say, where are you? 1980, August 12, 2 o'clock. She described live where she is. It's not, oh, I was. No. She speaks as it is live, right now. And if something bad happened to her at that moment, she screams, she cries, mamash live. In the middle of the seance, they say to her, let's go to the year before she was even born. The time of the Holocaust, I think 1946. In the middle of the seance, first of all, he told her, let's go to 1950, no silence, no noise. She doesn't answer. Why? She's not in a body. That's why she's not talking. She was in heaven. Then he goes another few months back. She doesn't answer. Another few months back. She doesn't answer. Finally, he went, I think, to 1946. I'm not sure about the dates because that was a few years ago when I saw it. She begins to speak Yiddish. She's a Jew now. She was Jewish in her previous life. As she begins to describe that she's a girl, 17 years old girl in a camp, in the middle of the seance, she started to scream and cry and go crazy. And all of a sudden her head fell down, silence. What happened? She was standing in a line and the Nazis were shooting her. She was one of the people in line. As they got to her, they shot her. She was silenced in the middle of the regression. Regression! The best part is that they take a 70 years old man and they go back when he was 1 year old. Guess what he does? He goes on the floor and begins to crawl and make out of his mouth voices like a baby. 7 years old. He walks with a cane. He cannot move now. He's half paralyzed. All of a sudden he crawls like a kid, like a baby, and mamash make noise like a real baby. Cries, he wants milk, he wants mommy, mamash like this. Hard to believe, you see it, you freeze. You can't move. Where this information come from? This is how it works. Remember this. This was enough for you to hear from this lecture. If you remember this part, it was worth it for you. Every person, God created him with conscious and subconscious. What's the difference? A person is always recording information. Everything around you is being recorded constantly in your computer. However, since there is trillions of things that you are recording every hour, you record the area, all the people who walk in the street, noises, people honking, people talk in the background, in the news, things that you're reading, everything is being recorded. Everything is recorded. You don't miss one beep in the street. If you stand on Fifth Avenue and thousands of people scream, every one of them scream a different word, and hypnotize, when they hypnotize you, you're going to know all the words you heard. Right now, you don't know any word because it was all noisy. When they hypnotize you, it all comes out of your subconscious. How does it work? The brilliance of God is that everything is being recorded, but only the things that you need daily or weekly are in the conscious. The irrelevant things automatically goes to the subconscious. If one day you're going to need it, what's going to happen? In 1 second, it goes from the subconscious into the conscious. Oh, where were you? I didn't see you for 5 years. You didn't think about him 5 years. When you saw him, your subconscious took his picture and his file out of your subconscious and brought it into your conscious. How does it work? A person walks in the street. His wife looking at him from the window. He looks at the floor while he's walking. He walks, he looks around. He comes home. She says, hey, Vinny, how you doing? Yeah, okay. Why are you looking at the floor when you walk? Can you tell me everything you saw from the bus stop until you got home? He said, what, are you crazy? I have nothing else to do in my life to look at the floor. He said, what do you mean? I saw you from the window. I saw that you're looking at the floor. He said, I wasn't thinking about the floor. I'm thinking about how much money I lost in Wall Street today. I care about the floor. What the floor? She said, okay, I just thought you're looking at the floor. Okay, a minute later, she needs to hang a picture on the wall. Vinny, where can I find a nail? I want to hang a picture. Do we have nails? Oh, wait a minute. I just saw a nail 5 minutes ago on the floor. Let me go get it for you. He goes down next to the bus stop. He sees a nail. He picks it up. He comes to her. Here is a nail. Before, when they ask her, when she asked him, what did you see on the floor? He could not name one thing. He saw millions of things on the floor, but he couldn't name it because it didn't go through his conscious. It went directly to his subconscious, everything. Once he needs it, look how brilliant is the system. Before Bill Gates, before Microsoft, we already have a sophisticated computer. You know how it came to the world? From explosion, such a system, boom, an accident happened, and now you have such a computer, very nice. So now the subconscious records everything. Now, in Israel, they started to catch thieves through hypnotizing the people that got robbed. How? An old woman walk in the street with her press. Somebody come with a motorcycle. She goes, he grab it from her hand and drive. The woman falls on the floor, you know, he pulls it. She was trying to... Then they wake her up. Hey, what's going on, grandma? So she said, can you tell us who stole the press? Well, I didn't see anything. I just heard a noise of a motorcycle behind me. And a minute later, I was on the floor. You couldn't tell us the plate number? No. What motorcycle? One guy, two guys? Nothing she knows. Now they take her to the Israeli police and they hypnotize her. And guess what? Through the hypnotizing, they find out everything. The plate number, how many people were sitting on a motorcycle, the guy had an earring, mustache, this, tattoo, everything. How did she saw this? What's behind her? Everything is recorded in less than a second. Trillions of things are recorded in your brain all your life. And the interesting part is, your previous lives is all recorded in the same soul. This subconscious, this is what we call the soul. It's all recorded. That's why the Torah say, watch your eyes. Don't let things that are forbidden entering your system. You will never be able to get them out. Whatever enters into your conscious or subconscious, it's there forever. No way to erase it. That's why the Torah was very clear. When we say Shema Yisrael, Lo tatu ruach levavchem v'achrei enechem. Don't look at things that you're not supposed to. And don't listen to things that you're not supposed to, because there's no way to erase it. No way to erase it. If you met tshuva about it, you can ask God to forgive you. But to erase it from your soul, you cannot do it. And it's a divine soul. You contaminate the soul. And that's a problem. So remember, everything that you see is been registered 100%. And when they hypnotize a person, they just take him to that moment and they speak to the soul, and the soul leaves the moment. And this is called regression. Maury Bernstein from Colorado in 1956 published his sensational book Following Brady Murphy, describing a woman named Ruth Simmons. Remember her previous life, that she used to be Brady Murphy in Ireland in the 19th century. In the middle of regression, she started to say historical places, and she speak in heavy Irish accent. And they started to follow her and to see if it's a trick. Obviously not. She remembered her previous life. They published an article about her in Life magazine, an American magazine. And I have many, many cases about regression. One woman, remember, she's an Indian princess. She lives in a palace, and she described how beautiful is the palace. How sad to know that you used to be a prince and now you're a shoeshine. Oh, so bad. This is what I used to be and what I became now. Anyway, since I don't have time to describe you all these beautiful things, some of them are Jews hiding in shelters. 800 years ago, when the Goyim came to burn them in the synagogues, they describe live in the middle how they hide under the... And it's interesting because in one of the places, they went there to York, and they went into that synagogue, and they saw that this synagogue doesn't have a basement. Say, how can it be? She said that she's hiding under the synagogue. Only a few years later, they did construction, and they found a secret stairs that goes a little bit out of the building, goes into the basement, right under the shul, exactly the way she described it. Let's see some of the pictures, as I said. Hold your chair tight, please. I have no guarantee. Don't get nervous. This is what the camera detects when people took pictures. They're all around us, but we are not aware of them. This is a picture we were taken in Auschwitz, 1992. A person took picture of the bathrooms in Auschwitz. As he took pictures in Auschwitz, he never dreamed that a week later when he come back to America and develop the picture, they're gonna find a soul of a person, as you can see right here, eyes, nose, mouth, chin, an image. But when they took the picture, they couldn't see any. But the camera detects what the eyes of a person cannot see. Here is, shh, please, I need silence. Here is, you have to understand, I read in Hebrew, and it takes me a second to understand what I read. And then I have to translate it to English. So while I'm thinking, I have to translate. If you're all talking, it's confusing me. You know? So, the captain of this group, as you can see, this is picture of all these pilots that they decided to take a picture. And the captain of this group kept this picture. It was taken after their last mission in a war. And as they took the picture and they developed it, right between these two pilots, right here in the middle, they saw another person. Who is this person? 3 days before he died, someone turned an airplane on and the propeller of the airplane hit his head and killed him. 3 days before the picture was taken, he died. But when they took the picture, somehow this guy got permission, and as you can see, this is in a larger picture. It's right in between those two guys. This is a spirit. That's not a real body. But this is a spirit. You don't see the entire face. Everybody got shocked. They saw their friends inside the picture. In November 1995, a building was burned in the United States. Tony Horiel, a photographer, was called to take pictures of the building. When Tony returned home to his studio and developed the pictures, he saw an image of a girl staring at him, a spirit. Later, after an investigation, they found this is a girl that died in 1977, 18 years earlier, and she burned some buildings and disappeared, and nobody ever saw her. Where is she? She's reincarnated inside fire. Same thing, she burned buildings. When they took picture of another fire, all of a sudden, her spirit is right there. This is a regular family picture. Nobody will ever dream that when this guy with these two kids and somebody standing right here, when they develop the picture, they see right here another boy. And this is larger. You see, boy, blonde, eyes, nose, mouth. All these pictures, by the way, were checked by laboratory to make sure there's no tricks here, you know, Photoshop, these, all these tricks. So they're all authentic. Otherwise, you can get millions of pictures that people can fabricate, you know. But this is a picture from a typical picture from the 19th century, as you can see. Look how modest the going used to be in the 19th century. Only 100 years ago, not only the Jews used to be modest, even the goyim, how the women are dressed. Look, none of them bikini or tight clothes. All of them Baruch Hashem cover exactly like the Torah, the halacha. You see? Did you see any not modest woman? What happened to us in 2 generations? We lost our values, but that's besides the point. Shh. When they took a picture, they found their granddaughter, 6 years old, that died 2 months before that picture. She is reincarnated in a siding of their house. But there are a few images. One, two, you see? One, two, there's another face here. This is a larger This is right here, nose, two eyes, this is her forehead, the hair, this is the mouth, right here. This is the girl that died. She was 6 years old. She died 2 months before they took the picture. When they developed the picture, they were very, very surprised to find their granddaughter. This is Tracy, was born on Friday the 13th, June 13, 1975. When they took this picture, look, there are other images in the back. Nobody knows what they are. Look, you see right here, more images. It's not so clear, but they found it's like someone is almost like holding her hands. One time I came home, I got a phone call from a woman from Queens, and this is what she said. There's more good pictures, relax. Take a minute break, you know, because it's getting worse now. She tells me, Rabbi, well, I have a problem. My girl is now 16 years old. Since she's very young, every night she goes up to her bedroom upstairs. And she, in the beginning we were very nervous, but you know, over the years you get used to it. She comes to me and say, Mom, I have a girl sitting on my bed. We go up, me and my husband, we don't see anything, but she sees. She sees the girl, we don't see. We took her to psychiatrist, this. She doesn't say anything. She just said, there's a girl sitting like this on my bed, and she doesn't move. So I said, okay, so why are you calling me after so many years? She said, because what happened now got me very, very worried. What? Last night, I hear my daughter screaming like crazy in a room. I ran upstairs like crazy. I see her on the bed, going like this, holding her neck and screaming, and her head is going left and right, very fast. I didn't know what to do. I started to scream. All of a sudden, she opened up her eyes and she said, the man was trying to choke me. So I said to her, what man? He said, you know the girl that I'm telling you that she always sitting here? Now, today, she came up with a man with a hat like this. The man was holding her hand and he came. And when we saw me coming to the room, he got very angry at me and he was trying to choke me. What should I do? He sent her to a Kabbalist to take care of it. What can I do? But this is just to give you an example. And I have many other stories, not exactly the same, but similar, of things that they are, we have around us and we are not aware of it. Now, this is already a digital camera. May 5th, 2001. When they took a picture of this little girl, look at this. Somebody else is in a picture. Another girl. Nobody knows who she is. This girl thought she's alone in a house. Her boyfriend is taking a picture on her, but somebody else invaded her privacy. Now, I want to see if you're going to be able to see all these witches. In 1985, they took hundreds of witches to a forest, and they hung all of them and they killed them. I just want to know if you have good eyes and you can see their images. Pay attention. Shh. Please, concentrate. Just when you think it's over, you're wrong again. Shh. Pictures in cemeteries. Look, shh. In the middle of the night, the camera detects all kinds of things. This guy took a picture, but he doesn't know what's around him. When they took the picture, those things were not there. What are they? We don't know. Here is a picture in a cemetery, and you can see all the graves. You know, and circles, but nobody knows what they are. Over here, this guy has a stomach ache. He ate too much chulent, and he didn't know what's right in front of him. When they took his picture holding his belly, or this couple, there are things in the air that when the person that took the picture obviously didn't see it. The camera was able to see it. The dog is sleeping. Wait until he opens his eyes. And the cat is seeing it. You see? The cat is able to see things that we cannot see. Here is this girl wanted to have a fun day and somebody else wanted to play with her. Oh, that's a famous one. You know Ted Danson, the actor, no?
Yeah.
Is he still alive?
Yeah.
I am surprised he stayed alive after this movie that he filmed. There's a film that called Three Men and a Baby. Remember it?
Yes.
They filmed that in an apartment. They rented an apartment for a wealthy guy for the movie. As they filmed the movie inside this apartment, one time the editor is looking into the shots and he got very, very surprised. He called everyone and he said, "I don't understand. Who is this boy? He's not a part of the film." So they said, "What are you talking about? When we filmed it, he wasn't there. We filmed the entire day. He wasn't there." They started to call people. "Anybody saw that boy hiding there in a room, in a closet?" Nobody knows who he is until they call the owner of the apartment. And when he saw that picture, he started to cry. That's his son that killed himself with his own gun, committed suicide a few years before. The spirit of that boy is still in the same apartment. They didn't see it, but the camera that shot the film was able to see what the eyes of a person cannot see. This is a boy, the son of the owner of the apartment. This is an authentic picture from the film. And this boy somehow became a movie star. This is a picture in Portugal. Nobody knows what it is, but obviously it's a person. Here is a picture of this woman. Nobody knows what's outside. Here is a picture of this baby. This is an old, angry woman. Hashem Yirachem. I like to clap myself. Thank you very much.